one other thing. On behalf of 10X Ladies, this is our first annual 10X Ladies Award. I can't think of anyone else who deserves this more than you. 10X skill. 10X badass. Yeah, I'm after what I want. Money that I'm getting for investing not to float. 10X badass. I'm gonna give you what you need. Okay, this woman is phenomenal. I mean, phenomenal, okay? She's an actress. She's a humanitarian. She had a breakout role as Audrey Griswold in Vegas Vacation. Do y'all remember it? How cool? She currently stars on Riverdale. Any Riverdale fans? Woo! And she is currently an informant, an undercover operative in the United States and abroad. I mean, that's crazy. Marie Claire magazine has dubbed her the Hollywood vigilante. She's been a part of numerous covert operations, leading to the successful arrests of dozens of sex traffickers and child predators. Yes. As well as liberating numerous women and children. Thank you. In 2015, she founded her own nonprofit called Foundation for a Slavery-Free World, where she focuses on broad-reaching dissemination and education campaigns to prevent women and children from ever falling into the hands of these monsters. So before she comes up, I'd like to direct your attention to the video and introduce Marisol Williams.
Okay, so this is my face after infiltrating a trafficking ring, a massage parlor trafficking little kids, and a whorehouse in one fucking day. So we're in the safe house. I've been practicing my accent all day.
Go, 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 go! I'm through.
Marisol Nichols.
Marisol Nichols.
Please welcome the fabulous Marisol Cat Nichols!
Marisol, I think you shocked the world when you shared your story that while you've been starring on Riverdale, you have been working to stop sex trafficking and to catch these horrible people in this world.
I'm an actress. To me, it's like, okay, I just have to think about this as a role. I remember this one op that we did. I was pretending to be a kid.
Do you want me to come to you or what?
Yeah.
Get your hands on, get on the ground! Police department, get on the ground now!
You gotta go to a place that you never would ever, ever want to go, and you gotta play that part perfectly.
It's worth it. It's worth it. It's worth it. It's worth it.
Thank you all so much for coming. Thank you, Elena, for letting me be a part of this incredible two-day event. I'm so honored to be here with you all. And I want to especially thank you for coming to my talk because, you know, it's a hard topic to hear about. So I really, really, really appreciate you coming. Also, fair warning, I don't think there's any kids in the crowd. But if there are parents, it's a dark subject. So, you know, I'm going to show some videos that maybe they don't want to see. Just warning. Or you maybe want them to see. It's up to you. Okay, so many of you know me from my acting career, right? I been on shows like 24, Riverdale. I've starred opposite guys from Chevy Chase to Chris Rock. I am also a single mom to an amazing, amazing teenage girl named Rain. We have a very special relationship that I'm very proud of, and I've worked very hard for that. I also have a nonprofit, as Elena mentioned. And from time to time, I work as an undercover sex trafficking agent. So, thank you. So I'm gonna get a little personal, and I'm gonna say things to you that I normally don't say in huge settings or in the public eye. I've only mentioned it a few times, but I'm gonna give you a little bit of my background, if that's okay. So I was born and raised in Chicago, Illinois. And that's right, thank you. To a father that was always, always, always drinking. That's pretty much the memories that I have. He always had a beer or a bottle of wine in his hand. And his answer to life was essentially violence. He didn't really know much else. And for some reason, that was always, always directed towards me, not my two younger brothers, just me. And I could never figure it out. I thought that maybe there was something wrong with me. And I found out later when I was 16, long story, when I was getting kicked out of one high school, going to another high school, I found my like private papers. And in there, that's where I found out he wasn't my biological father and no one had told me. But it explained a lot. My next door neighbor, growing up, pretty much molested me from the age of 5 up until the age of 11. And he was doing this to a lot of the girls in the neighborhood, but no one knew and no one was talking about it. And for me, it sort of, I think it started me down this path, if that makes sense. My mom was always, 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 always sick. Always. Always in bed, fairly miserable. And so I didn't really have a place to go to talk to anyone. It was a far cry from my, you know, career now as an actor. I was the girl in high school, you know, that goes into like the lunchroom with the tray and you're like panicked because you know there's nowhere to sit and the mean girls won't let you sit with them and the boys are over there. I was that girl, right? Extremely introverted, extremely self-conscious. I was picked last for the teams. I was considered a loser. I would be called, hey, loser, like that girl, right? And then in eighth grade, we moved, and I had to go to a new school. And over that summer, I got a hold of some makeup, and I put makeup on. And I went into this new school, and I was the new girl, and none of them knew that I was like this loser from the other school. And the girls were nice to me, and the boys were nice to me, and everyone was sort of nice to me. And I made new friends, and I made this one friend. And I'll just say her first name, just because. Her name was Sally. And Sally invited me to a party and asked me to spend the night at her house. Don't tell your parents, but we're gonna sneak out and we're gonna go to this party. And so we did. And I got to this party, and there were 6 guys there. And me and Sally. And it was the first time I ever drank. I was 12, 13. First time I ever did drugs, nothing. And the last thing I remember, and I've talked about this a little bit in my podcast if you've watched it, but is one guy walking towards me with a giant bottle of Seagram 7 and saying, drink. And I did. And I smoked 2 bongs, those things, if you forever, you know, any former people in here. Thank you. Just little giggles. And that did it. I was like 95 pounds. I have 3 memories from that. I remember waking up on the bed, just my shirt on, nothing on underneath. And one of the guys walking towards me naked, and all the rest lined up on the bed, watching and laughing. I remember being out on the sidewalk. It was February, it was freezing, and I remember the guy kicking me, going, get up, bitch, and asking me, like, where do you want to go? And I pointed to the police station that was literally around the corner. And they dumped me on those police station steps and rang the doorbell. And then I remember waking up in my own bed, not knowing how I got there. My underwear was on crooked the wrong way. And it hurt, for lack of a better word. And somehow or another, everyone in this freaking town knew. Like, this news traveled like wildfire. And I didn't go to school for 2 days because apparently I also got hit by a car. And so I had a sling on, and when I got to school, it was like slow motion. It was walking down that, you guys remember freaking junior high and high school, and you walk down that hall, and like all the lockers are on either side of you. And I remember walking down that hall, and it was like slow motion. Like, the entire school was converging on me at once, and I'm hiding in my locker, and it's, hey, doggy style. Hey, how was your weekend, Marisol? Did you have a fun weekend, slut, whore, dun, dun, dun? I know what to do. My mom heard about what happened and grounded me, said that's what you get for drinking. It was her way of, you know, she had her own stuff going on. And even the teachers. I remember the teacher, second period, pulled me aside and goes, you know, Marisol, you should be careful. I heard about what happened over the weekend, and a girl can get a bad reputation. So it was, I didn't know what to do. So I turned to drugs. I was like, fine. You think I'm a bad girl? I'm going to be a bad girl. Watch this. And for the next some odd years, I did every drug that I could get my hands on. I did more drugs before I was 15 years old than anyone should ever do. It was a bad scene. I ran away a ton of times, and I pretended to be this really tough girl, right? Because I was just angry. Inside, I was completely different. Inside, I was terrified. Inside, I was a completely different person, but the drugs sort of made me think that I was like, I can just numb and forget and kind of handle everything until I couldn't. I had a very warped sense of worth. I was very self-destructive, and it was a rough time. My dad ended up going to prison for several years. My younger brother killed himself. It was rough. And about the age of 17, I looked around at the older people that I was hanging out with, and they were starting to go to prison. I mean, I had one friend that went to prison for 20 years. I have another friend still in prison for murder. And something clicked, and I just looked around, and I was like, if I don't change something, this is my life. And I just knew it. I'm gonna end up dead or in prison. And so I literally, something clicked, and I quit. And I mean, quit everything. And I'd been smoking, I quit smoking, drinking, everything. And I, thank you. Thanks. And I also lost all my friends, because that's who I was hanging out with, right? But, yeah, you can applaud that, that's right. Thanks. And so, what happened was kind of serendipitous, and to me, it comes from that decision that I made of, like, I better change the course of my life. And I had nothing else to do. And I was in that, you know, the three-year college, if you guys know that. And I tried out for a play, thinking, I'll just be an extra. Like, I've always kind of wanted to be around that, and who knows, and I'll be an extra. And they ended up giving me the lead role. And I was like, what? Like, you don't want me? This is not me. And I got into the room with all of the other guys in the play, and I was like, oh my God, it's the theater geeks. Like, this was so new to me. And I fell in love with it. And it changed my life. And eventually, I worked my way up and I moved to LA and there you go. And the rest is not necessarily a Cinderella story, okay, because Hollywood is brutal. But that's another speech for another time, and we're not going to get into that. But that's the point. That's that part of my life and where I came from and what sort of opened the door for me looking at this subject, which I'll now explain how in the world did I get from there to what you saw bits and pieces of in the video. So back in 2012, I have a daughter, Rain. She's 4 years old. And I make friends with this woman who was traveling around the world educating people about human rights. And she started telling me about human trafficking and kids and sex trafficking. And she would use words like child brothels. And I was like, what? What do you, like, I can already feel in the room those words, right? And child sex trafficking, those words do not belong ever in a sentence. And I was horrified and upset, as anyone would be. And I couldn't sleep. And I didn't understand how one person could sell another human being, and then how one person could do it to a kid to the tune of millions. And so I've always believed that if you want to do something about something, you have to educate yourself first. You have to know what it is first so that you know where there's a hole or what can you do or how can you be of help. So I dove in and I learned everything that I could learn, and I met with anyone who would meet with me. And fortunately, I had been on 24 quite recently, so I could go to DC, and for some reason, they just, you know, they think, oh, 24, she knows the government, let her in. And they would let me in. It's true, so true. And I could meet with anyone, and the senators would meet me, the congressmen. I met with Homeland Security, I met with ICE, I met with the State Department, I met with the executive branch under Barack Obama in the White House. All, thank you. But also, I could learn as much as I could about this subject so that I could do something about it. So I'm going to pass on a little bit of that knowledge to you. So you hear different numbers. I'm sure you've heard different numbers, right? There is one source called the Global Slavery Index, which is the source that pretty much everyone in the anti-trafficking movement uses, including from the United Nations to the White House, everybody. About 10 years ago, globally, there were 21 million people enslaved. Today, 50 million people globally are enslaved. Today. It's called modern day slavery. And if you don't believe me, look it up. I'm sure you all are going to wait, what, huh? And want to verify that. That's true. The shocking part is that over 70% of them are women and children. That's incomprehensible. There's literally 6.3 million women and children caught up in sex trafficking. And there's sex trafficking, by the way, in all 50 states in the United States. And I know, you think, when you hear of these things, you think like, oh, those poor people in Thailand or Cambodia or the Philippines. And you think of these scenes that are separate, you know? Unfortunately, it's not. Have you ever heard of something called sex tourism? A little bit, right? Some people say what? So sex tourism is a thing. And certain countries in the world are known for this. Meaning, men travel to those countries to have sex with kids and all kinds of aberrated, yucky stuff, right? Thailand is one of those countries. Cambodia is one of those countries. And guess what? The United States is now one of those countries. We're literally called a sex destination tourism country. And that's disgusting. And the profile, by the way, the profile of who travels abroad or travels to countries to have sex with kids are white, middle-aged American men. That's the profile. Now, in the United States, it's literally American citizens for the most part. There's not really a need to bring kids from other states and other countries over, because trafficking is supply and demand, and we've got the supply and the demand right here. And what makes up the most of it in America, a lot of those kids are foster care kids and runaway kids. And they're literally referred to in the anti-trafficking movement as throwaway kids, because no one's looking for them. In fact, there was just a law passed by one of my board of directors from the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, passed a law, because this was not a law, that if the kid that you're fostering as a foster parent goes missing, you didn't have to report it to the government or the police, right? And a lot of these people wouldn't, because they'd still get their check. So it's fine, it's a law now, but law enforcement is catching up to this, you know what I mean? Yeah. So how did I get to be an undercover operative? So I'm gonna tell that story. So have any of you seen Sound of Freedom? Great. All right. So that movie is about Tim Ballard. That's my partner. Thanks. So I met Tim back in 2013, 2014. I started holding these red carpet events in Hollywood because I firmly believe that trafficking was allowed to occur because no one knew about it. No one was talking about it. So if I could hold an event in Hollywood and invite a whole bunch of people to the red carpet, then I could spread the word. How am I doing on time? Okay, I'm doing good. Good. So I'll tell you a little secret that not many people know. So I'll give you an example. So you're an actor, you have a publicist that you've paid, right, to get you publicity. And then you get invited through that publicist to red carpet events. Some of those red carpet events are for charities. So what happens is your publicist calls you up and says, hey, Marisol, listen, InStyle is hosting a fundraiser along with Smirnoff and someone else, and it's gonna benefit schools and backpacks for children. Great, I'm there. Why? Because InStyle is covering it. Just being real, okay? So I'm gonna go and I'm gonna get my outfit, and I'm gonna get the stylist, and I'm gonna put it all on, and then my publicist is gonna give me a cheat sheet. And that cheat sheet is so I can memorize it in the car on the way to the red carpet, so that when Access Hollywood puts its microphone in my face and says, why are you here? I can say, I'm here because there are 55,000 students in America that don't have backpacks, and we need to support backpacks for children. And it looks like I've shown up for the cause. It looks like all of us have. But just to be blunt, most of us are there because InStyle is covering it. So I thought, okay, good, I can do this for trafficking then. So I went and brought all the people that I had met along the way of learning these things, and I'm like, I'm gonna throw a red carpet event, and I'm gonna invite my friends in the industry and the Associated Press and everybody else, and then they're gonna repeat those same cards. Except for I'm gonna surprise them, and instead of having an open bar when you walk in and a dance party, they're gonna learn about trafficking. And that's what I did. So they did, and a lot of people came. Terry Crews came, Kristen Chenoweth came, Kelly Preston came. We had a lot of really beautiful, wonderful people that were like, I'm there. Long story short, my second year that I was doing this, I needed a keynote speaker. And someone said, oh, I think you should meet this guy, Tim Ballard, who just left the government. He's former Homeland Security, former CIA. I'm like, great, I'll meet him. So I go to meet him. We hit it off completely, and I'm like, oh my God, you're the guy I've been looking for. Because who goes and gets the kids? It's all great to tell people and raise awareness, and that is what I obviously need to do and want to do, but I also want to go and get the kids. So, yeah, thanks. So he came and he spoke and we hit it off. And then a couple weeks later, he said, hey, do you want to come to Haiti with me on an op? We're going to do an op. Why don't you come with us? And I was like, yeah, I'm still doing this whole research. I'm learning. I want to see. I want to understand as much as I can. So I go. And we go to Haiti because he's investigating a house that's used for organ trafficking. I know. Sorry. On the way back, we're in a small plane, and we need to stop in Louisiana to refuel the plane. But they're also tracking a guy, a white, middle-aged American male, who he's been tracking for a while because he travels around to different countries and goes to these sex parties where kids are. So he looks at me and he says, I need a female operative. Can you do this? And I'm like, what do you mean? Like now? And he meant now. And I'm like, and the plane's like descending. And I'm like, okay, what do I do? And right away, like we had the stuff there and he put a baseball cap on me and a hidden fucking camera. Oh, sorry. Sorry. thank you. And a hidden camera in the pen and recording and like little recording devices and all that so they can film everything and goes, okay, so listen, here's the story. We just got back from the Dominican Republic. You're the girl who we travel with to set up the sex parties. We want to know where this guy is going next so we can track him, and so we need to know that, and we need to know who his contact is and blah, 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 blah. Okay, ready? And I'm like, uh-huh, and we go. And, you know, thank God I'm a good actor, because I had to right away come up with a character, like what kind of person, female, would travel with men and set up these parties. So I did, and it worked. And we got what we needed, and we got the intel that we needed. And from time to time, this is what I do. Thank you. So, as Elena mentioned, I'm a deputized legal informant. So what that means is when I'm on an op, I am essentially law enforcement, right? So everything's above boards. When I go to a foreign country, they take my passport. I am now working for that government. I have immunity, all of that stuff. Like it's literally like the movies. Like we have helicopters standing by to get us off the islands that we're on in case stuff goes bad. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna show you behind the scenes into one of the ops I did with Tim back in, I think this is 2015. This was in a small area called Sutter County, California, right? It's a little small area outside of Sacramento, California, right? What we did is, so we put an ad in Craigslist. And Craigslist has filters, just so you know. So we put an ad in Craigslist that said, hey, man and woman in town, 3 days only, 9-year-old, 12-year-old girl, needs someone to educate, in quotes, while we watch. I was like, oh, but the more warped, the more real it is, if that makes sense, to these guys, to the predators that show up for this. And so then we're holed up, and you're gonna see this, we're holed up in a godforsaken motel for many days, and you're gonna see there's hidden recording equipment, hidden video in the hotel room that Tim and I are in. We trash the room so it looks like we're partying the whole weekend, so we look like the right people. I've got meth scars over my face because we travel with a makeup artist and all that stuff to make us look messy or whatever is needed for the most part. And so we put this ad, and this is in Yuba City, it's called, small town. put this ad in Craigslist, within 15 minutes, we had like 45 appointments. It was insane. And the police that we were working with, the vice squad, they were shocked. They had no idea this was going on in their community. No clue. So the first thing that happens is they email back and forth. And as soon as the guys put in writing that they want to do this with a child, that's and they're talking to what they think is a child, that's felony number one. Right? Most of the time, they send dick pics. Sorry. But they do. It's the weirdest thing. That's felony number two, though, because they're selling it to a child, showing it to a child. Then, when they show up, then we just confirm that they were the person that we were talking to online, and we're okay, and that can be felony number three, right? But if they need to come in the room, if they haven't said in the email or they haven't done anything, we need to get them in the room and we need them to talk about what they want to do so that we have it recorded and all that. We turned all over to law enforcement. Okay? Tracking?
Yeah.
It's a lot. Okay. And then the last thing that you need to know are the really, really, really bad guys that have been doing this for a very long time are smart. And they ask for something called proof of life. Prove to me that there's a kid there. Prove it. And so that's when Tim hands me the phone, and I talk like a little kid. So you're going to see that. Are we ready? We can dim the lights and roll that op footage.
Hate that you love him.
Yeah.
Copy that.
Yeah, she's right here. She's right here. She's right here. Yeah. Remember the guy you talked to before, sweetie?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's here. He's on the phone.
Hi, guy.
Hey, how you doing?
I'm good.
So you want me to come see you or what?
Yeah.
What do you like?
She's funny. She's hilarious.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, she's good, man. She's totally. We've trained her, dude, from a young age. She's good. She knows what she's doing. Kind of. You got to kind of show. You got. What do you? Yeah, just tell her what you want. Just tell her what you want her to. Just tell her what you want her to do, and she'll do it. So. So if I look out, just so you know, so if I look out the door, I see like, I think it's a Staples. It has like a red roof. It looks like a Staples, like right across the parking lot from me.
Into this, so he's now giving him instructions to come this way.
Get on the ground.
Police department, get on the ground now!
Okay. They're calling me. Go tell them.
Tell them what?
The bad guys are calling me. Hello? Hello? Hey. Oh yeah, dude. Hey. I put her on for you. She left a message for you. She's right here. Get her to come. Okay, here she is. Okay, just talk to the guy. He's the guy that was gonna come.
Hi.
Hi, kiddo.
Hi.
Sorry.
Are you coming?
Well, I was a little worried.
Why?
I like to play. I wasn't sure. I wasn't sure what you were wanting.
Anything like sex?
Do you want to play?
Yeah.
She's still. The nine-year-old's asleep, but she's awake. If you still want to come, that's cool, dude.
Sit down here. I'll just get. Sit like you're relaxed. Yeah, baby. Yeah, it's cool.
What's up, man?
Sir John?
John.
All right, dude. Let's go, sweetie. She just ran upstairs. She's ready, though.
Okay.
She's ready, dude. Dude, I'm glad you came.
Hey, I've got to be careful.
No. Yeah, well, we all do, man. We all got to be careful.
Police! Get down on the ground!
Get down on the ground!
Get down on the ground!
I'm down.
On your knees now.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you. I know that's disturbing. Thanks. Thank you. So, as you can see in the video, we see some pretty disgusting people. We see some pretty horrific things. That guy in the video has a 15-year-old daughter at that time. He was the head of the Energy Commission for the town. He had been doing this a very, very long time, and the judge threw the book at him, and he got the most fullest extent of the law punishment that you could get. So he's done, just so you know. So back in the day, I'm just gonna try and educate real fast and try not to go over, but back in the day, you heard about the white van, right? Avoid the white van. The white van is now the internet. That's what you as parents that I'm speaking to here need to watch out for. I'll give you an example. These are real life cases, okay? Because if you think about the internet, just think about Facebook. Let's just use that as an example. Anyone can put up a profile. Anyone can go on the internet, and that's exactly what is happening right now. So in real life, this girl, this is a real case. It's now, I think, the 11-year anniversary for it. This girl was chatting with a boy online through Facebook for 3.5 months. He had, here's his picture, all his high school, like activities that he does, all of these things, all there, visible, that you could see and go through the pictures and the posts and everything, right? 3.5 months. She finally agrees to meet the guy. She's like, okay. Excuses herself from the dinner table and goes to just to meet him in the driveway, because he apparently just got his license. She goes to meet him in the driveway. Guy rolls down his window. It's a 30-year-old guy. Goes out, breaks her wrists, put her in the back, and she's gone. Rapes her, videos it, and puts it on the dark web. How she got rescued was a guy that was watching those videos, recognized her missing child poster, told the FBI, and they got her out. I tell you that story not to freak you out, and I'm sorry, and I know that this is a lot. I tell you this as one of 1,000 examples of what happens and what can happen. I'm gonna skip the other ones because it's just too long, but you get the idea, right? And the worst thing, and I think what the hardest pill to swallow, is there's female traffickers. I see just as many. And I come to face and you would not know. You would not know. And I think that's the hardest pill to swallow, because to me that's the biggest betrayal to your own group that there could be. So I mentioned before that trafficking is supply and demand, right? So who is creating the demand that's resulting in a supply of what is now, I think, 4.4 million children. How is that created? So my reality is through pornography. If you think about it, this is not my job, okay? I'm just stating something. Back in the day, if you wanted to see two strangers having sex, you left your house, you had to go down the street, you had to wear a hoodie, you go into the CD theater, and sit in back and hope no one sees you, right? Now, you just click it. That's it. Pornhub, and you can do your own research, is in so much trouble for the amount of those videos, like I described, being put on their website. Why? Because it's user-generated. Anyone can upload this stuff. It's called now CSAM, Child Sexual Abuse Material. And there's literally hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of child sexual abuse material on Pornhub. And any guy can click it and watch it. And if you watch something enough, it seems normal. It seems real. And you go, well, if it's on the internet, there's all these, I must not be the only one. And it makes it somehow okay. And there's another organization I work with called Fight the New Drug that talks about this very thing, that if you, pornography can act as a drug so that you don't get the same effect unless you start going down the rabbit hole to darker and darker and darker stuff. And you can use the rest of your imagination, but that is how, at least one way, you can create a demand for this, where it's normal. You know, the most searched videos on Pornhub are like rape, choking, brutalization, teenage. Those are the search terms. And that's the most popular search terms. Anyway, according to the 2020 Federal Human Trafficking Report, it states, U.S., that over half of trafficking victims in the United States came from online social media platforms, messaging apps, job boards, and online chat rooms. That's the new white van. They can reach your child now through Instagram, through Facebook, Roblox, Minecraft, Discord, any chat. So you have to educate yourself because they are prowling for these kids. My daughter, Rain, was doing there's this amazing game called Sky for children. I don't know if any of you know it, but it's an actually beautiful, beautiful app. It's gorgeous. Very high, you have to pay money to do it, like $35, $40 to even join. You would never guess. But they have chat, you can just chat with like your little characters, sure enough. There was a woman on there named Abura who was gathering. Mama Rain's like, Mama, she has all of these kids around her, always, and she wants us to call her Mama. She wants us to tell her our problems. And she's so like, oh, poor little blah, blah, blah. His parents are mean to him. Da-da-da-da. We should all feel sorry. These are the tools that these guys use because they're trying to find the troubled, vulnerable kids. And they try to get them on other apps away from there, like Discord and things that are not being monitored. Good Lord, delete Discord if your kid has it. So I can talk all and on, and I won't take too much more of your time. I created a podcast through my nonprofit, Slavery Free World, called the Marisol Nichols Podcast. Very easy to find. It's free. And I did it on purpose, and I invite Tim's on there. We show all this undercover footage and things that we haven't shown and all the different experts that I work with or that I've met throughout. And we talk about how to educate and reach mothers, children, and teenagers, because that's a big part of my audience through Riverdale, so that I can prevent these kids from becoming a statistic. We just literally 2 weeks ago interviewed the head of Meta, the head of Facebook and Instagram and global child safety. First question, how do we protect our children? And she's fantastic, and she goes over all the tools, and we're gonna have her on over and over and over. And I invite you to listen to it, it's free. Now, I'm going to show you one last thing. This is going to be a bunch of different undercover clips that I've done sort of over some of the years. The biggest one in there is this op that we just did in, well, it was in the Dominican Republic. And to this date, it's one of the scariest ones that I've ever done. The colonel basically asked if we could go into this resort because they suspected that the three biggest traffickers in the country were in this resort and they were holding a bunch of women, basically because a 15-year-old girl escaped and ran to the police. But these guys are smart. And the only people they let in the resort are American citizens. So Tim and I go in and we'll play husband and wife, like the most warped husband and wife you can imagine. But it works. And I have to tell you, we were the ones doing the reconnaissance, so we were the one getting all the like schematics of like, okay, here's how you enter, here's how you leave, here's how many girls are there, here's, yes, that's the trafficker, no, that's not, everything like that. What we didn't know is when you walk in, they lock you in. And we had no idea. And when they, because there's 6-foot walls that come in that, like the beach is right there, but it's like up there, right? So you can't see and you're locked in from all sides. And I just want to tell you, I'm terrified. I'm not walking into these places like, woohoo, I got this. I am second guessing myself all the way. And I wrote a letter to my daughter on the last two because just in case I don't make it, I don't want her thinking that mama died helping someone else and not her. So I wrote her, thank you. I wrote her a letter saying, I'm doing this for you, so that you can grow up in a world where you don't have to worry about walking down the street or who you're talking to on the internet, and it's safe for you. And when I walked in, I turned to Tim, and I'm in character, and I whisper in his ear, I'm like, I cannot do this. I can't fucking do this. And he's like, yes, you can. And I'm like, okay. And we did end up identifying the three biggest traffickers in the country. Thank you. We did 5 ops in 4 days, some of which you'll see. That initial op, we got 27 women and children out who were trafficked from Venezuela for 2 years to the DR. Thank you. And you're going to see them in there. Thank you. You're going to see about 8 girls that, to your eye, are going to seem like they're there voluntarily. And when we rescue, they're bawling, they're free. And you wouldn't know it when you first look. So I'm going to try and pause some of it to talk about it, but otherwise I'm just going to let it roll. So we can go ahead and roll that, please.
All right, in action.
That's hostage training.
Remember that time?
And then we just pounce on you.
That's Tim sent 2 Navy SEALs to my house to take me through hand-to-hand combat, literally. And so that's these guys that we were working with at that time. Go ahead. That's part of the op you already saw. That's Jason. These are our disguises that we were trying on and trying to figure out. That's Maddie. We're a dead, by the way. You don't sleep on these things. You can pause it for a second. This is right out of the resort. Like, we had to switch cars in case the car that we drove in had tracing equipment on it, if that makes sense. And this is like right after, and we're waiting for our guys from the safe house to come and pick us up and switch out cars. So,
why are you not sleeping?
Dude.
Your mind plays.
I'm not going to sleep until LA.
She wants to meet me, look in my eyes. Apparently she wants to look into my soul, is what I've been told. So this should be fun.
That's part of the disguise. That's a little girl that is being trafficked by that woman. That's with Michigan. I did some things with the sheriff, Chris Swanson, out of Michigan. Meth scars, as you could see. That's a cop that we de-aged. That's us holed up in another hotel room. This is a takedown of a church member. Oh, that's the Craigslist, if you can see it real quick. Visiting Yuba, gentlemen, family fun experience, girls 9 and 13. You see how that's like spelled out there? It's to go against their algorithms that stop those things. You can go ahead. That's me and the sheriff and Tim. Guys that we got in custody. That's our wonderful Sir John, whose life is ruined now. Thank you. This is a safe house. We're getting briefed about right before we go into the trafficking resort. Pause it for a second. That's the colonel. So she's the female colonel in the DR, in the Dominican Republic, that's responsible for all trafficking, and she's the one who asked us to come. Okay. Thank you. Thanks. These are the girls we got out, part of them. You're going to see them in a second.
It's okay to pay now.
Yeah, we're good. Yeah, vamos a pagar.
He's the trafficker. Don't they look like they're there happily? They're not. That's us taking that guy down that you saw. Ran away and hid. This is the resort. Let's pause it. It looks really pretty, right? You would never guess. You'd never guess. Okay, go ahead. Sorry. Thank you.
No, really didn't tell us about it. Yeah, it looks very nice.
This is where men travel. It's 5,000 a night. She's 15, by the way. American men. Americans only. Right there on the beach. Gorgeous Dominican Republic. Pause it for a second. You know, my co-star, Vanessa Morgan, she's on Riverdale, had texted me if I was going to her baby shower at this time, and I was in the airport. I'm like, I can't, I'm in the Dominican Republic. She's like, oh my God, fun. No clue, just saying, fun story. Okay, go ahead, sorry. That's the trafficker, pause it for a second. Can you go back? That's the guy. You would never know. Night, look, right in the face. He's bringing me chocolates, trying to keep me happy the whole time. You would never know. Okay. It's another different country that we were in.
Buen trabajo. Ese era el tipo que queríamos. Ya te es.
And that's our second team, basically, where we're switching out cars. And then we turn it over to them, and then they stay there and do all the other work. Just training, you know, giant gun. I just included that because I think it's cool, just to be honest. And these are kids. They live in those places. Look at, that's their living, that's where they live. Pause it for one moment, you're about to see. So they live in those, they work for an American company, this is all labor trafficking in the border of Haiti and Dominican Republic. And there's adults in the corner, and essentially while all the older ones are working, the adults are having a free-for-all. Go ahead, you can press play, I just want to set that up. But that's how they live. That's the inside.
Yeah. Monsters.
And those are the kids.
And there they are, there's the monsters. Aren't they nice?
Those are the monsters. Awesome. And these are kids that were rescued. As you can see. Oh, that we brought them a bunch of toys and a bunch of stuff just to, because they don't have anything, you know? So we were handing out stuff for them. They're great kids. And then this is Haiti, and this is a bunch of kids that were rescued after the earthquake. And they're good. They're in a really great, great facility there. Thank you. So, thank you. I really do want to say thank you.
I want to thank
you. For your courage. Thank you for everything.
Thank you, Marisol Nichols. Marisol, before you take off, I have instructed the team to put up a QR code with your willingness. 10X Ladies would like to raise money for your nonprofit, Slavery Free World. Go ahead and take a picture, you know, photograph this. And I thought it would be an amazing opportunity for us throughout the next 2 days to continue to raise money for you for these activities that you're doing. And we'll periodically update as we go as to where we're at, and we'll just play a big game on it to support you and show our deepest gratitude for all that you do. Thank you. And also, one other thing, on behalf of 10X Ladies, this is our first annual 10X Ladies Award. I can't think of anyone else who deserves this more than you. This is the 10X Ladies Woman of the Year Award. Thank you for your insurmountable courage. Thank you for risking your life to free women and children. I applaud you. You are really such a warrior, a leader, an inspiration. You make me want to be better, and I want to support you, and thank you. Thank you so much for all that you do, Marisol.
Thank you. Can I say two words?
Sure.
Thank you, everyone. I just wanted to let you know that those ops that we did led to 87 now women and children out of that country. And in the spirit of 10X, let's turn that 87 into 870.
Yes!
Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you, Marisol Nichols!